hello, welcome back to Let's Talk H.P. Lovecraft. It is once again Sunday morning, and I am doing a review of another Lovecraft short story. Coming down with a little bit of a cold, so please excuse me if I have a gagging fit or need to stop to blow my nose. Anyway, guys, this week's story is The Lurking Fear. It's a 1923 short story, published first in Homebrew magazine. It's also been adapted into film in some way or another three times. Dark Heritage in 1989, The Lurking Fear in 1994, and Bleeders in 1997. As with so many of Lovecraft's work, most likely you're going to recognize similarities to these stories in other movies that aren't really officially adapted as being such. This short story, I think it was serialized. It's divided into four chapters. The Shadow on the Chimney, The Passer in the Storm, What the Red Glare Meant, and The Horror in the Eyes. The narrator is sort of ahead of his time. He's like a paranormal investigator. I think he describes himself as a connoisseur of horrors. But after these grisly murders near a place called Tempest Mountain in the Catskills, this sort of strange, secluded mountain area with this really weird proclivity for lightning strikes. Reminds me of, I think there's a lake in Africa where they say it's the most lightning struck place on Earth, where something about the topography attracts lightning. But so he goes to investigate, and he's convinced that whether the culprit is real or ghostly, that it centers around this place called the Martens Mansion, which is a secluded mansion in that area. It was built by a Dutch family in the 1670s. They were trying to get away from the incoming English rule to the area. And then it's occupied for centuries. Family becomes increasingly recluse, and then is believed to have died out. This family is known for the strange color of their eyes. Most of the family members have one eye that is blue and one eye that is brown, and that is a very important element, as you shall see. So our narrator, this ghost hunter, as I'll call him, he decides that he's going to spend the night in the mansion with two companions who he's hired to watch the to watch each other's back, and they set up ladders in the windows and sort of barricade themselves in this room. And it's almost like something out of like a ghost hunter show today, like on Sci-Fi. And despite their vigilance, his two companions end up dead, and well, dead and missing. He's traumatized by these events, but he's not discouraged. He eventually teams up with a reporter named Arthur Monroe. They discover a diary written by one of the Martens' ancestors. And they get, during the investigation, they get trapped in a cabin during another thunderstorm. And the reporter is killed. He has his face chewed off. Very pleasant stuff. By this point, he is convinced, our narrator that is, he's convinced that Jan Martens' ghost, that is the ghost of a member of the Martens family who, unlike the rest of the family, he actually got out of the area. He joined the military, fought during the war, and saw the world. But when he comes back, it's believed that his family killed them, sort of seeing him as a betrayer for going and dealing with the outside world, which they've become so cut off from that they see it as an evil. Using the diary, our narrator discovers the location of the grave of Jan Martens, and he begins digging, trying to find the body to see if he can uncover the truth behind this mystery. In the course of his digging, he sort of falls through into a tunnel, and it appears that there's a tunnel system. So he crawls through it, and as another storm is striking, he gets a glimpse of something in the caves, this weird set of eyes and a creature with claws. Months later, he returns one more time, and he notices from a higher vantage point that there seem to be these weird hills and channels in the terrain surrounding the mountain, sort of leading back towards the mountain, towards the mansion. And at that time, as he's digging, looking for a tunnel, a very violent storm hits, and all of these bizarre creatures that he describes sometimes as rat-like and other times as ape-like, but they come pouring out of these tunnels by the thousands. And just as the story ends, sort of the last hurrah that ties the whole story together, he notices that most of the creatures, or all the creatures that he can see, they have one brown eye and one blue eye. just like the Martens family who occupied that area. Ta-da! So yeah, guys, that is a great sort of twist ending that ties everything together. And what it's doing is it's bringing up one of Lovecraft's favorite themes that I'm finding, which is sort of genetic and social degradation, apparently through centuries of inbreeding and breeding with lesser peoples, the local immigrant populations, sometimes described in the books his writing as being mongrel people. They've mixed, and this once high Dutch aristocratic family has fallen all the way to more of an animalistic, ungodly sort of state. And I think there's quite a lot of talk about Lovecraft as being a racist. I know he was sort of an Anglophile. He was really enamored of English society, proper English society. He sort of saw that as a pinnacle. And that's not surprising. You know, he's a New Englander. And even today, sort of that sort of stuffy aristocratic demeanor can be found in certain, you know, usually political and wealthy families. But he's writing in the 20s. You know, we think of, racism still being pretty rampant at that time. Yeah, it's rampant today in some places, but, there would have been not quite sanctioned in the North, but fairly acceptable racism against, African descent, and then also a lot of these immigrant populations coming in from Eastern Europe at the time. And then, of course, we're on the cusp of Hitler rising to power, and there's always a sort of an anti-Jewish bent in civilization for some reason. So he's been somewhat accused of racism, I guess, of being a racist, and that doesn't really matter because that's his personal life, and you really need to separate personal life from the text when the text is fictional. So I think the message is is somewhere else, and I think that message is that his family seeks to cut itself off. And I think when you, when the Martens has cut themselves off, that is sort of the cause of their downfall. They, being alone like that, they stagnate and then eventually digress into sort of this lesser nature. And that's how you think about it. We've had throughout human history, great societies have come and gone, and then you have these gap periods in between where, yes, you may have smaller sort of strong civilizations, small community, but in general, there seemed to be this sort of loss of knowledge and this loss of power and sophistication. So you sometimes when you cut yourself off, it doesn't have the effect you think you have, and I would actually suggest a sort of an anti-racist theme, which is we're better people when we're bringing in outside blood, outside influence, because it makes us better, it makes us more diverse, it makes us it brings us new ideas, new ways of thinking, things that are apart from ourselves. It sort of renews the gene pool, figuratively speaking, not literally speaking, which it does that too. And it makes us a better civilization. And I think if you choose to see that theme, it's a good one to think about today, especially in the current state of things in America, where our own president is sort of stoking these anti-immigrant, anti-foreign, America first sentiments, which are very dangerous. We're less than a century removed from a time when, if you're a typical American, I guess, I don't say that in a racist way, but if you're a fairly typical American, we're not far removed from World War II with the Holocaust, nor from slavery itself another 50 years before that. So it's a very slippery slope, and it's we're not that far as a human civilization, even, 8,000-10,000 years, we're not very far from being cavemen. And you sort of see this theme played out in modern fiction right now, like with, take The Walking Dead, for example, where a few years after, the apocalypse, they're struggling to maintain any semblance of human civilization, of sort of human ideals of behavior. And you see throughout that series, throughout that universe, all of these little groups who have descended into all of these different types of living, everything from sort of feudalism to cannibalism to monarchy. And we gotta watch ourselves, guys. We may have this computer here, we may have cars out on the street, but it doesn't take much, and we may be a lot closer to our animal ancestors than we think we are. So be careful. All right, guys, that is all I have to say, I guess. Oh, one more thing. In terms of the writing style in this, I've reviewed three of his stories so far, including this one, and there's still a little bit of awkwardness at time, a little bit of that sort of thesaurus-y, speaky, wordy thing that he does, where it's not quite usual protocol for writing. But at the same time, there are some passages in here that actually, in their wordiness, in their ridiculousness, actually border on the poetic, which is a good thing. As with my previous review, I did listen to this one in audiobook form while I was reading, and it was really enlightening to hear a good narrator tell the story using their voice, and it really really brought the whole thing together in a way that I'm sort of missing when I read his stories alone. I have this critical mind. It goes back to my college education, where I have a hard time accepting a lot of stuff, but hearing it out loud really brought it home for me and made it a lot more enjoyable experience. So I'm going to continue doing that as I do these reviews, as long as there is an audiobook easily accessible to me. So yeah, guys, that is it. Hope you enjoyed this story. It's got some messages going on, which is important to me as far as my ability to enjoy a piece of literature. I'm going to keep doing these. I may sidestep. Next review may actually be back to Tolkien. I'm going to talk about Farmer Giles of Ham, I think. But then I'll be back into Lovecraft, and we'll do something creepy and ridiculous probably for Thanksgiving and Christmas coming up. I was doing Christmas reviews during Halloween season, so I'm going to do Halloween reviews during the Christmas season. I think I want to talk about the movie Scream is coming up on an anniversary here pretty soon as well. Came out on December 20th in 1996, I think. So should talk about that too before Christmas. But thanks for tuning in. Thanks for listening. Please subscribe, and I'll see you next time.